morning. How's everybody? Good. Good to see you. My name is Pastor Jason. I'm the lead pastor, and we are going through the book of Joshua. So if you have a Bible, we're going to be in Joshua chapter 6. If you remember before, this is probably one of the most famous of the narratives and accounts in the book of Joshua because it has to do with the walls that fall down, right? You've seen it or heard about it. Stories are told about Jericho and the walls that fall down. And so we left the Israelites last week, middle of the chapter. They're going around the walls every day, one time, 6 days in a row. They're blowing trumpets, they're not saying anything, they're silent, and the ark is in their midst, and they're just kind of following those instructions. They're waiting on the Lord, they're surrendered to the Lord, obedient. We talked about those things a little bit last week. But I want to pick up this morning as we get into the middle of this chapter. I want to kind of begin with something that's a hard topic. So it's a topic that most people don't like to talk about. Most people don't like to talk about the bad news side of things. They don't like to talk about the judgment of God. It's a hard kind of truth to realize. Like, we like to kind of keep it simple and keep it sweet and easy. And yet the reality is that the good news isn't good until you know the bad news. You've got to understand the bad news. And if you look through the scripture, you'll find that there was no one that talked more about hell than Jesus, because he came to save us from hell. So the bad news and the good news, they go together. And so this morning I want to talk a little bit about the judgment of God. It's a book, Joshua's a book. I was reading, you know, there's different people, they don't even like to teach this book because it's talking about God's judgment, and it's, you know, a people are coming in and taking this land that belongs to someone else. And so it's a little bit hard to understand and hard to swallow. And so what I want to do first is I want to talk about why God is the judge. What is it about who God is that makes him the judge, and really the best one to be the judge? Most of us don't want to be judged. We don't like when someone judges us. But the reality is that for there to be a just world and for there to be justice, there has to be a judge. And so I'm going to give you four kind of reasons. I don't have them on the screen, but if you want, I will. If you get the email, I will always include the notes with it. But here's the first reason. First reason why God is the judge is that God created the world, and he is therefore the rightful judge of the world. In other words, God made it, so he knows how it's supposed to work. It's not something where it's just this like random a chance, an occurrence, and here we just happen to all be here, and God shows up and he's like, oh, look it, here's a world I'll judge. No, God designed the world. God created the world. God created and gave life, and so he knows how life works. And so he is the rightful judge because he is the one who created it. Second reason why is God is the perfect judge because God is perfect. So in his perfection, he is the perfect judge. He doesn't have a bad day. He doesn't have malice. He doesn't have a temper that you want to avoid. It's not like, you know, if you ever have to go before someone in court, or you have a boss that's over you, or you get pulled over by a police officer, and you're just hoping, like, I hope this is a good guy, right? Like, I hope he didn't have a bad day. I hope he's not going to take something out on me from who he is or what he's dealt with, right? Because as people, we're all imperfect. We all have bad days. We all have baggage or history, and yet God is perfect. And so he can judge perfectly. There is no malice in God. There is no like crack in his integrity. God is a perfect judge because God is perfect. And the reason why many people don't want God to be the judge is because they don't see him as perfect or understand that he is perfect, right? But the Bible shows us and teaches us that God is perfect. And so he can be the perfect judge. Third reason is that God judges with righteousness and mercy. God judges both with righteousness and mercy. Righteousness in that he has full knowledge of what is right. right? Full understanding of every person's life and history, right? The complete story is what God has. So he judges rightly. I don't know if you ever think about this, but when I'm in a crowd or a bunch of people or, you know, talking about a mission trip, the reality that God knows that 15-year-old boy whose father murdered his mother and brought him into Pastor Juan's house and brought our students and Jimmy to interact with him, like, it's amazing, right? It's unfathomable, but that every person on the planet, every one of the billions of people, God knows intimately, right? God understands perfectly. And so he judges rightly, but he also judges mercifully, because not only does he have perfect knowledge, but he has perfect and full understanding. It's like, you know, the company, they came up with that slogan, he gets us. Because he gets us. He understands perfectly. Doesn't just know perfectly, but he understands. He has mercy. He is rich in mercy. The Bible teaches us that he is rich in mercy. So with both righteousness and mercy, he judges. He's not the, like, you know, hang him high judge. Like every time, judgment, judgment. He is righteous, but he is merciful. And so he uses both of those things as the establishment of his throne. And the fourth one, the last one that I'm going to mention, is God's judgment is avoided with repentance. So because of his mercy, he always makes a way out. The Bible teaches that he always provides a way of escape. And in fact, the way of escape from the judgment of God is the cross. So he doesn't forgive like he just forgot about it or ignored. If you've ever been in a situation, maybe your kids do something or your spouse says something or your friend, you know, doesn't do something that you wish they did, and you just kind of ignore it. You know how that is? Like, oh, I'm just going to pretend like you didn't say that. I'm just going to pretend like that doesn't happen. God doesn't pretend that we have done something we shouldn't. He knows it. In fact, he knows every thought. He knows every intent of the heart, not just the actions. Right, but he doesn't ignore it. He provided a way. What is the way? The way is the cross. So Christ came and he paid for every sin that we have done, that we will do, every sin is paid for. The blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin. And so coming to Christ is the way that we can avoid. If you come to God, he forgives. If you reject God, there's judgment, because he is the just judge, and so he provides a way of escape. So the big idea as we get into this, it's pretty simple. I'm going to put it up on the screen for you. The Bible teaches that we all sin, that we all have sinned, and we all do sin. All right, so we start off with sin. Sin and continue to sin equals judgment. That's what the Bible teaches. You sin, I sin, we all sin. It equals judgment as we continue in that sin. But sin and turn to him equals salvation. We all sin. We've all fallen short. But if I will just simply turn to him, you're like, how can it be that easy? Because someone else has already paid the price. It's not easy. It's simple. Turn to Christ and he will save you. We saw that before. We'll see it again specifically this morning as we go through the scripture and the story of Jericho. So the thing that I want you to remember, the message title this morning is The Judgment of Jericho. The thing that I want you to understand is God is not, you know, choosing his favorites to give something that doesn't belong to them. God is giving something to the Israelites, the land, the promised land. He's giving them the promised land because he is judging the Canaanites. So if you go back in the Old Testament, if you go all the way to Genesis, if you remember when we went through Genesis and we talked about Abraham, at that time, Abram, and God said, listen, I'm going to give you a land. But if you remember, what he said is, I'm going to give you this land, but not yet, not now, because the iniquity or the sin of the Amorites is in full. He'd been giving them time to repent. hundreds of years come from the time that he promised to Abraham till it actually happened. And during that entire time, it's mercy. It's a time of mercy and an opportunity for repentance. But when the line was crossed, when the cup was full, the deal was done and God was going to bring judgment, right? And you know how that is if you've had a family or had a boss or, you know, whatever that person in authority, and it's like you can push it and you can push it and you can push it, and then you cross the line, right? You can go so far and it's like, uh-oh, dad's mad, right? Like, okay, we've gone too far. You try to back away. Like, okay, now he's ticked. Okay. Like you have the opportunity to repent until the judgment comes. And so this is the judgment for Canaan. Now, if you read through the Old Testament, if you actually like go through the Old Testament, I spent time teaching the Old Testament when I was teaching at the high school. And there's stories in there that are just ridiculous, right? There's the most grotesque, crazy stories of sin in the Old Testament. And all of those occur in Canaan, because that's how crazy this place was, right? One commentator talked about the Canaanites as the whole culture. They committed the sins of idolatry and temple prostitution and adultery and homosexuality and incest and murder and bestiality and gang rape and child sacrifice. That's their norm. That's just how they lived, right? And the farther you get away from God, the darker it gets. And, you know, like when they go down to Cajabamba and Cajamarca and these places in Peru and some of these places in El Salvador that are far from the gospel and the light of God, it's dark. And the human heart, it's a dark place without God. And so what was unique, one of the things that was unique about, you can see all of this sin in the Old Testament in the land of Canaan. One of the things that was even like worse about it is child sacrifice was done in different places throughout the world. It's a horrible thing, right? But what was unique about Canaan, they would take their own children and sacrifice them. It's one thing to take a child from someone else, but they would take their own children and sacrifice them to their gods. And so finally, God had enough, and he was bringing judgment. So the judgment of Canaan was on the judgment of God was for their sin. It was justice for the wickedness that they were living in and that they were practicing. So I'm going to read you this out of Deuteronomy. So before they come into the land, Moses, God speaks through Moses, and he says this in regards to the land: not because of your righteousness or the uprightness of your heart are you going in to possess their land, but because of the wickedness of these nations, the Lord your God is driving them out from before you, and that he may confirm the word that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. So what is God saying? God's saying, listen, it's not because you guys are so great, because you're not. Right? I'm just going to give you this land because you guys are amazing. You're not amazing. But these people are being judged. And so you get the opportunity. It's like they're being driven out. I'm going to bring you in. But you know what he says to his people? He's like, listen, but if you fill the land with your sin and your sexual perversion and your violence and your abuse of people, if you fill the land with that, I will drive you out as well. And that's what he did, because God is just. And he judged Canaan and he judged the Israelites just the same. And it took around 400 years, but after God warned them, he drove them out. And the Assyrians came in, conquered the north, and the cities in the south, still countries in the south, still tribes in the south, still wouldn't repent. And the Babylonians came in. And so God is a just judge. He judged the sin of the Canaanites and he judged the sin of the Israelites, and he judges my sin and your sin. He's a just judge, and the way to avoid his judgment is repentance. It's to come to him. It's to trust him. So he knows and defines what is right, and he is the one who judges and disciplines what is not. And so how is this relevant for us today? Well, It's the same God. God is the same. He is a judge. He is the just judge. But in our culture and in our time, we, like we said before, like we don't like to be judged. Don't tell me what I'm supposed to do. Don't tell me what I shouldn't do. I get to decide what makes me happy. Right? And we don't want somebody to judge me. We don't want somebody to judge us. And as Christians, our role is not to judge. Our role is not to condemn. Our role is to follow Christ. And Christ said, I didn't come to condemn the world. I came to save it because the world is condemned already. They're lost already. They're broken already. They're condemned already. I have come to save, to seek and to save the lost. And so for us as believers, it's relevant for us because our country and our culture is farther and farther away from the light and the truth of God's word. And so if you're a Christian, if you're a believer, what we believe is what God says. And we find what God says in the Bible. So all the things in our culture right now that are like these hot topic issues of like the Christians that are intolerant or they're ignorant or, you know, they don't care, they don't love. These aren't things that we have made up. As a church, like we haven't just decided like, okay, what will really tweak people? What will really be like really offensive? Let's pick some of that stuff. No, all we're doing is reading the scripture about what God says and sharing that. Hey, this is what God says. Why does God say this? Because God created us and God gave life to us and he knows what works well. And so he's like, hey, listen, this isn't going to work well. The wages of sin is death. This is going to bring separation. This is going to bring destruction. This is going to bring difficulty in your life. And if you look around at nations and our nation, the farther away you get from righteousness, the worse things become because the human heart is wicked because we're all sinners. And without him, there is no salvation. Right? It's not that there aren't good people or the people that do good things. I'm not saying like there's plenty of nice people that do nice things. But the hope of life is found in Christ. And so I'm just going to touch on some of these things that it's like, okay, well, why do you guys believe that? I'm going to tell you, we believe this. We say this because this is what the Bible says. And as God's word, like this is what we believe. We believe what God says is right or good, whether we understand it fully or not. Because there's things that I'm just going to tell you, I don't fully understand. I don't have all the answers, but I have chosen to trust Christ. I trust God. From the experience that I've had and from the things that I've seen and the way that he's worked, I trust him. And a God that I can fully understand isn't a God that's worthy of my full worship. Right? And so one of the things that's a hot topic is right now marriage between a man and a woman, right? The Bible says marriage between a man and a woman. That's not something that we made up. It's not something we've like decided. Go all the way from Genesis all the way through. I'm just going to give you one verse. It's out of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5:23 talks about marriage. How did God design marriage? Well, it says, for the husband is the head of the wife. It's a husband and a wife. That's how God designed it. As Christ also is the head of the church. So God has set an order. The husband is the head of the marriage, the wife, and Christ is the head of the church. And so there's a relationship of love and submission and respect and care and service. But it's between a man and a woman. That's what the Bible says. That's how God says life works well. The sanctity of life, right? The sanctity of life, the unborn child. Right now, that's a huge issue for people. Like women are saying and men saying, like, you don't have the right to tell someone what to do with their body, right? You can't tell someone what they decide with their pregnancy. Well, the Bible actually teaches us that baby inside is a person, right? Jeremiah tells us, God speaking to Jeremiah, he says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you and I ordained you a prophet to the nations. So this is a person inside the womb. There's a person with a purpose and a life and value and a calling, right? And they're not even born yet, right? So we respect and protect that life that is unborn. Male and female genders being distinct and different, right? Our culture is very confused about that right now. Like, well, I don't know. Is it really? Like, I just was seeing, I think it was a, I don't know if it's the new passport or something. There was like male, female, and then like something else, X or something. It's like, no, the Bible teaches all the way from the beginning through the end that there's men and women. There's male and female. And you're like, well, I don't agree with that. That's totally fine with you. I'm just telling you what God says. That's it. Like, I didn't make this up. God did. And he created the world and life. And so this is what he says. Genesis 5, chapter 5, verse 2, he says, he created them male and female and blessed them and called them mankind in the day they were created. So there's a distinction. There's men and women, and that's it, right? That's what God says. And everything else is confusion, right? Everything else is missing what God has designed. And missing what God has designed is missing the mark. It's missing out on life. Homosexuality is a sin. That's another one that's big in the culture right now. It's very intolerant. It's unloving to say it's a sin, but the Bible teaches it's a sin, right? That's what the Bible teaches. That's what God has revealed. Now, people can choose, like, I don't believe that. That's totally fine. You can choose your own way. You're just going to be responsible for that outcome, right? Whether the judgment of God or the forgiveness of Christ, like both of those. There's a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is death. That's what the Bible tells us. So Romans chapter 1, verse 27 tells us this. It says, the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. So God's like, hey, this is an error. This is missing the mark. This isn't what I have for you for life. Last one I'm going to touch on is sexual activity outside of marriage, right? Engaging in sexual activity outside of marriage, you know, that's a very common thing. If you're engaged, you're sleeping together. If you're just a young person, you should be having sex. That's what the culture would tell you. It's healthy, it's helpful, it's good. And yet, it's not, right? Like, you can see where this leads. And if you follow the line out far enough, you realize, like, wow, that actually was a lot of baggage. That was a lot of pain. That was a lot of difficulty. There's a lot of problems that come with that. And that's what God says, right? That's how God has revealed. So Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4, it says, marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. So there's a judgment of God on all those that are sexually immoral. It's wrong. It's outside. It's missing out. Oh, it's so fun. It's pleasurable. It's short term. All sin feels good at first. Like, there is no temptation with something that's not enjoyable, right? It's sometimes people are like, oh, you should try this. It tastes nasty. I'm like, that is not tempting to me, right? I'm not tempted by that. But if it tastes good at first, like, hey, that's tempting. But you got to look further, and that's what God does. God has an eternal perspective. And so he tells us, hey, this is the way of life. This is the way of death. This is the way of separation, difficulty, destruction. So God is righteous. He determines what's righteous, and he judges righteously. And that's who God is, and that's how God is. And for some of us, that's hard because that means I've got to change. But thankfully, that's the opportunity that we all have. The opportunity we have is to change. Paul in 1 Corinthians said this, chapter 6, verse 9. Paul's talking about the kingdom of God, and he says, don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Well, uh-oh. We've all done wrong, right? We've all done wrong. So now we're screwed. What's going to happen now? Right? Those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God. And then he goes on, don't fool yourselves, he says. Those who indulge in sexual sin or who worship idols or commit adultery or male prostitutes or practice homosexuality or thieves, greedy people, drunkards or are abusive or cheat people, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. That's bad news. I mean, I won't make you raise your hand, but I'm guessing some of us can find something here where they're guilty of. Right? Like, that's the truth. Like, oh, I cheated on that test in seventh grade. Done. I've been perfect since then. Done. You've done something wrong. Talk to your spouse. I'm sure you've done something wrong, right? We're all guilty. And that's bad news. What am I going to do? Well, the good news is verse 11. Paul goes right on, and this is what he says. He's like, look, some of you were once like that. Some of you were once like that. But you were what? Cleansed. You were made holy. You were made right with God. How? By working really hard? No, by calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. You see, salvation is simple. Call upon the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. And judgment is real. So when the Israelites are coming in to Canaan, this is the judgment of God that is righteous and merciful. And we'll find the same thing, righteousness and mercy. This is not some kind of like strong military power that's coming in to take the land of the Canaanites. This is a weak bunch of people who used to be slaves in Egypt and have been wandering the desert for 40 years. And God is displacing this strong, wicked group of people out of the land. He's driving them out. And God is righteous and he's just. It's not about race. It's not about nationality. It's not about power. It's not about property. It's about the judgment of God, right? And God judges the Canaanite, the Jew, and he judges you and me because he's a just judge and he brings justice. So with that foundation, let's jump into chapter 6, verse 15, and we're going to kind of walk through the scripture and make a couple comments here. So Father, as we open your word, we pray that you'd open our hearts. God, it's a hard moment to hear bad news, to hear truth that we don't measure up. But it's good news to know that we don't have to measure up, that we can come to you and be forgiven. That we can receive grace and mercy in time of need. And so we pray that you'd speak through your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. All right, so verse 15, it came to pass on the seventh day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and marched around the city seven times in the same manner. So Jericho is not a very big place. It's about 6 acres-ish. Right? Less than 10 acres is Jericho. So you could probably walk across it in less than 10 minutes. So they are now traveling around it seven times. On the day only they marched around the city seven times. And on the seventh time it happened when the priest blew the trumpets that Joshua said to the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. It's already done. Now the city shall be doomed by the Lord to destruction, it and all who are in it. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all who are with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. So here's our first point. This is what we see right off the bat. Judgment and mercy come from God. Judgment and mercy come from God. Rahab is receiving mercy because she turned to the Lord. And she's like, man, I heard of you guys. I know what God has done and I want this. I want you to protect me. I want to come into your this relationship that you have with this God. And so she receives mercy. And the rest of the Canaanites, the rest of the people in Jericho, they lock the walls. They're pushing God away, right? They fight me, right? That's some people's attitude towards God. Well, fight me. You want to judge me? Judge me. It's like, okay, that's not a fight you're going to win. But Rahab receives mercy because she came by faith. Then next we see in verse 18, it says, and you, now he's talking to the Jews there, those that are marching, by all means abstain from the accursed thing, lest you become accursed when you take of the accursed thing and make the camp of Israel a curse. And trouble it. But all the silver and gold and the vessels of bronze and iron are consecrated to the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So you see, Jericho is the first city in the promised land, and it belongs to the Lord. That's what God is telling them. Listen, the first goes to the Lord. The firstborn belong to the Lord. The first fruits of the harvest belong to the Lord. And this first city belonged to the Lord. And see, what God is doing is establishing an order. And that order is simply this: the Lord first works best. The Lord first works best. Many of us, we get saved and we are thankful for our salvation. But Jesus doesn't come just to be the Savior. He comes to be the Lord. And so he establishes, as he saves us, he's like, okay, I want to be your Savior, but I also want you to make me the Lord. And frankly, I'll just tell you, when I was younger, especially when I was younger, I was like, why does God want to be first? Sounds kind of stuck up. It sounds a little arrogant. Why does God have to be first? Oh, you have to be first. All the people that I knew that always had to be first were kind of jerks, right? And people kind of like put that off on God. Here's why God says to be first: because having him first works best. Because he knows how life works. And he's like, listen, you guys are going to need some help. You're going to need some protection. You're going to need some blessing. You're going to need some assistance. You're going to need me. So put me first and we're going to be good. That's what the Lord is saying. Put me first and we're going to be good. Well, I don't know what to do here. Put me first. I don't know what to do with this situation. Put me first. That's what God is saying. Put me first. That's what works best. That's the way that he has arranged life. And what a blessing that he would even be willing, right? That God would even be willing to help, to willing to protect. It's like, okay. It's like when you have a problem and you know you have a good lawyer, you're like, let me talk to my lawyer first, right? Let me talk to my lawyer. He's going to take care of this. He's going to protect me. He's going to handle it. That's the Lord. The Lord's like, hey, listen, don't go try to fix this on your own. Put me first. Now, this other thing that I want you to notice about this section that I think is really important is there's these accursed things that are devoted to destruction. And then there's these other things that are dedicated to the Lord. And so here's our third point, if you're taking notes this morning, is this: all we have is for the Lord. All we have is for the Lord. As they went into Jericho, all they had was for the Lord. So some of those things were dedicated to destruction. God was like, listen, that's got to go. This is not to be kept. And other things, he said, this I want you to bring to me. And it's so similar to when God conquers our hearts, right? When God brings his kingdom into our lives, he says, this has got to go. This needs to be destroyed. This needs to be set aside. And then other things, he says, this I'm going to use for my kingdom. I'm going to use for my glory. And so, you know, maybe before you came to Christ, you're sleeping with your girlfriend, your boyfriend, or you're unfaithful to your spouse in one way or another. Maybe you're angry or lazy or careless or selfish. And that's just how you live, right? Maybe you cheat or you lied or you just did whatever you had to do to get ahead. But he comes in as the king and he's like, okay, the way you've been treating that person, that's got to go. The way that you've been interacting in this situation, that's got to go. The way they've been controlling, like, that's got to go. And so he says, that has to be destroyed. Why? Because it's going to bring trouble. It's going to bring trouble, and we'll see that in a very real way. Before you came to Christ, you lived for your own glory and your own pleasure. But when you come to Christ, you live for his glory and his pleasure. And then he takes those other things in your life, and he's like, oh, listen, you know, you're such a great business person. This, I'm going to use that for my kingdom. Or you're a great athlete. You have gifts and talents. I'm going to use this for my kingdom. You have this, you know, this talent for cooking or listening or technology. And he's like, I'm going to use this. And there's times where God says, that I want to use for my glory. This, that needs to go. But I will tell you, there's sometimes in between. I remember when I first came to Christ, I knew God had called me to set aside surfing for a little while. And that was an idol for me. And I didn't want to set that aside. I wanted that to still be my idol. And the Lord's like, if I'm the Lord, that needs to go. And I had this like very real fear of like, am I ever going to get to surf again? Like, am I ever going to get to enjoy this again? Like, I don't know. And God set it aside. Why? Because I needed to get my heart right. And then at the right time, in the right way, all of a sudden I realized like, oh, he's bringing that back. Why? Because now it's not for me and my pleasure. It's to enjoy with him for his pleasure, right? And that's what it means to have him be our Lord and Savior. Some things he says need to go, and some things he says that needs to be for me and my kingdom. All right, so moving on, verses 20 on through, we're going to read this little section. It says, so the people shouted when the priests blew the trumpets. And it happened when the people heard the sound of the trumpet and the people shouted with a great shout that the wall fell down flat. Then the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, man and woman, young and old, ox and sheep and donkey, with the edge of the sword. So none of the plunder was to go to them. But Joshua had said to the two men who had spied out the country, go into the harlot's house, and from there bring out the woman and all that she has, as you swore to her. And the young men who had been spies went in and brought out Rahab, her father, her mother, her brothers, and all that she had. So they brought out all her relatives and left them outside the camp of Israel. So here she is now saved, right? Received that mercy. But they burned the city and all that was in it with fire. Only the silver and gold and the vessels of bronze and iron they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord, they would use that for the Lord's temple. And Joshua spared Rahab the harlot, her father's household, and all that she had. So she dwells in Israel to this day, because she hid the messengers whom Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. And if you remember, she's in the line and the lineage of Christ. Verse 26, then Joshua charged them at that time, saying, cursed be the man before the Lord who rises up and builds this city Jericho. He shall lay its foundation with his firstborn, and with his youngest he shall set up his gates. So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame spread throughout all the country. So here's our final point this morning is this. Do not build up what God has brought down. If God has come in, if Jesus has come in and made himself the Lord and the Savior, do not go back and try to rebuild what he has destroyed. There's a curse. There's a price, and this price was paid by the man who tried to rebuild and did rebuild Jericho. Right? If God has brought down your addiction or your pride or your lust or your controlling nature or your selfish ambition or your fear, do not try to rebuild that. Right? Like there's a really nasty proverb that talks about like a dog that returns to his vomit is a sinner who returns to his sin. Have you ever seen a dog throw up and then go eat its own vomit? It is disgusting. Right? And that is a very vivid picture. It's a nasty. Don't go back and, well, you know, I'm going to return to this. God's like, that is gross. Don't rebuild what God has broken down, what God has set you free from. But here's the thing, and I want to close with this because I think it's an important kind of idea to understand, is that what God has destroyed in judgment should not be rebuilt, but sometimes, like I said with the surfing, sometimes it can be redeemed, right? And when Jesus is the king, he redeems things. And so many, many years later, hundreds of years later, Jesus is actually walking on the streets and he's coming up to Jericho. This Jericho that was judged, this Jericho of destruction, right? And there's a blind beggar on the side of the road, and he's crying out. And do you know what he's crying out? He's crying out, Son of David. That is a title of the king. He is calling out to Jesus as the king. He says, Son of David. And people are like, hey, be quiet. Tell that guy to shut up. He's making too much noise. He's so obnoxious. And you know what the guy did? Even louder. He's like, Son of David. And Jesus hears him, and he stops, and he comes to him. And he says, what do you want? And he says, I want to see. And Jesus says, your faith has made you well. And he received his sight, and this is what it said. He followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise to God. So you may have judgment and destruction in your past. But if you let Christ, the Son of David, the King, come in, he will redeem what was meant for judgment, what was destroyed. That sin is paid for, and your life is redeemed and used for his glory. And that is a beautiful thing. And so this morning, as we close, we're gonna close in a song of worship. And maybe you have never given your life to Christ. Maybe you've never taken that step and said, I am giving my life to Christ. I'm putting my faith in Christ. I'm going to invite you to, there'll be a couple people down here to pray with. I'm going to invite you to give your life to Christ this morning. Or maybe there's a sin that you are holding on to. There's an idol that you have and the Lord's calling you to like cast that aside. You can come down and pray with somebody or pray with somebody that you're with. Or maybe you just want to give him praise and thanks and thank God for the work that he's doing, the salvation that he has. And after this song, I'm gonna see you over at the pool, because there's a young man that just this week on Wednesday gave his life to Christ and he wants to get baptized. So we're gonna baptize him this morning. So let's all stand, let's worship. If you wanna come down for prayer, there'll be a couple of people down here to pray with you.
You never failed me.
we're here in the baptismal with Landon. And we're excited what God has been doing. Landon and I were talking, the first time he came to church was Wednesday.
I've been praying for like a year and a half.
He's been praying and I think moving towards that, but first time in a church was this Wednesday, and Jimmy was telling me he gave his life to the Lord. And so I'm gonna ask Landon a little bit, like, so what is it that you think we're doing in here this afternoon? Why are we in the pool together? Yeah, what's God been doing in your life?
I didn't really grow up in a Christian like household. I have family members that are Christian, but me personally, like, my parents aren't. And so I guess it's been like a while since I've actually felt close to God or just anyone else, really. And I have amazing family members and friends who have talked to me about it, and I've just realized that, like, God is amazing. Like, I really wish I could have been closer, like, a long time ago, but I think I'm making a good decision to do it now, you know, better sooner than later. I don't know. I'm truly blessed to be here, and I thank all of you for being here, and I know that there's a lot of names, so I don't know if I can pray for all of you, but I'll try my best, and I hope you guys can pray for me. But I'm just truly thankful that you guys are all here today, so thank you.
Awesome. Exciting to see what God is going to do, right? Giving your life to Christ, you're born again, and you have a new life, and just like a baby, you grow, and you develop in a healthy way to continue to follow him and to know him. And so I'm going to have Jimmy pray for Landon, and then we're going to go ahead and baptize him. So, Jimmy.
Dear Heavenly Father, I'm just grateful for you, Father, and the gift that salvation is. Father, that through your Son, Lord, we can experience new life and life of abundance. Father, I'm grateful that you even allowed me to meet Landon, Lord, in the situation that we did this past Wednesday, that you gave him eyes to see, Lord, and a heart to receive your gospel, Lord. And thankful, Lord, for the life, the new life, Lord, that you are giving him today. Thank you for his boldness, Lord, to step out in front of all these people that he does not yet know, Father, but to be so convinced, Lord, of your great love for him. Father, he wants the world to know that he is a follower of you. So, Father, I pray that you would strengthen Landon, Lord, that you would give him a greater portion, Lord, of your spirit, that he would follow you all the days of his life. Father, that he would be a testimony to his unbelieving family, Lord, of the testament of the great love that you have, Father, that salvation is for all who come and to receive. Thankful, Jesus, that you are the God that everyone who comes, you will by no means cast out. So, Father, strengthen Landon, surround him through a church body back home, that he would grow in his faith. Give him all the gifts necessary, Lord, to be a minister of your word to the world around him. Thank you again, Father, for your great love towards us. Bless him and on his journey, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
That's pretty sweet. You think you made the right choice?
Yeah.
Amen. It's a hard thing to die to ourselves, but the reward is life and joy and peace. So I pray that this week you guys would experience that. You would be connected to that. You would abide in him and receive the joy and the strength and the peace that you need that comes by his spirit and his life, and that you'd be a testimony to those in this world, right? It's a dark world, and Jesus is a bright light, and he has sent you and I to be a light wherever you go. So God bless you guys. Thanks so much for coming. We'll see you soon. And don't forget to take a name and pray for one of our kids this week and volunteers. God bless you guys.
And all the plans we held for the future. The world that I once knew was in a cardboard box in the lobby, lost and found.